All right, well, let's get going. Welcome to the Security Studies Program Wednesday seminar. I'm Taylor Frabel, director of the program, and really delighted to welcome our speaker today, Neta Crawford, who is a professor of political science at Boston University, where she also has the perhaps dubious task in COVID of being chair of the political science department. So my condolences for that. Also, for our purposes, she's a graduate of MIT, received her PhD in political science, and was part of the Security Studies program, I believe, in the early 1990s. She's the author of several books, including Accountability for Killing, published in 2013, which examined moral responsibility for civilian killing in Afghanistan, Iraq, and Yemen. And she's also the author of Argument and Change in World Politics, Ethics, Decolonization, and Humanitarian Intervention, which is a terrific book. In addition, she co-directs the Costs of War Project and has written dozens of scholarly articles in all of the usual places, including one that I was mentioning to her earlier on the Iroquois League back in IO in the early 1990s. She's working on two book projects at the moment. The first, To Make Heaven Weep, Civilians in the American Way of War, which examines the treatment of civilians by the US military from 1608 to the present. And a second on military greenhouse gas emissions, which she will be talking about today to us. And so with that, I welcome everyone who's joined us on the live stream and would like to turn over the virtual floor to you, Neta. Welcome.
Well, thank you. And I'm gonna try to share the screen now. Let's see if it works. I think it is.
Okay, yep, there we go.
See everything that I have. Let me just start the slideshow. Apparently, I need to grant access to something. Okay, so thank you very much. I really appreciate this opportunity to be virtually joining you at MIT. What I wanna do is just quickly run through the basic facts here, and I'll have I have an outline that will take me about 30 minutes to get through. First, I wanna set the context for this work on military greenhouse gases and climate change. And in the climate science, past US military fuel use, current role of fossil fuel in war. Secondly, US DOD greenhouse gas emissions. I'm the only person in the world who's done this calculation, apparently. And thirdly, about how the US military thinks about fuel use and climate change, and fourth, how the US military is not thinking about it. So the scientific context you're probably all aware of, but just in case you're not, major greenhouse gas emissions have rapidly accelerated since the beginning of agriculture, but more importantly, since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. This slide shows that. Here are the major greenhouse gases. They're carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide. Then there are also fluorinated gases, which have an outsized impact, but which I won't talk about today. So methane from, let's say, natural gas or ruminants, cows, et cetera, and carbon dioxide. Nitrous oxide is also important. So as the atmospheric concentration of CO2 increases, so have global average temperatures. And here you see the seasonal fluctuations, but you get the idea. It's the curve is going up. Greater greenhouse gases, greater increase in temperature. So that's not news to you, I'm sure. So the IPCC consensus is that all of this will have significant impacts on the Earth. Global temperatures will continue to rise. They'll rise more quickly and will be higher on land. The mean sea level will rise. There's greater precipitation in some areas and drought in others. And then there's the potential for abrupt non-linear changes, that is, things that you wouldn't have predicted. It's quite important to keep that in mind. And here we have a little slide from an article today in a BU publication that asked, will BU be underwater in 30 years? If BU is underwater in 30 years, at least in part, so will MIT be underwater. Okay, so now let's think about the larger, much larger context of fuel use, and then we'll sort of drill down. So globally, in 2020, early 2020, we were on track to continue the increase in fuel oil use, crude oil, millions of barrels per day is the slide on the left, in early 2020, projected for the pandemic. And then, but we see, if you look at the slide on the picture on the right, is that the fuel oil use has decreased, and that just tracks the declining global economy. Now, let me just give you a brief history of military fuel use. And what you see in the picture of the shallop approaching Mayflower II is the olden days way of getting around. It was renewable energy, wind power, or it was the renewable energy of people's arms on oars. Then you see the sail, days of sail, when the sail ships get larger, and eventually what you see is coal, wood, then coal, and then fuel oil. And so the image on the right is the Navy's Great White Fleet, which was actually, if you look at it carefully or not so carefully, it's the Great Black Fleet, because it's burning coal and emitting lots of greenhouse gas. And what you see is that for the British anyway, and also for the US, this is associated with a lot of coaling stations, the need to get coal to store coal. So from the beginning of the use of fossil fuels, they've been tightly associated with, first of all, the need for bases if you want to have global power projection, and of course the need for a secure supply to the fuel. Then if you want to hurt the other side, of course, then you would engage in an embargo. And here we see an image, a cartoon of the oil embargo that the US began against the Japanese in 1941. And then lots of attacks on oil refineries were also part of the World War II strategy. This continues, the attacks on oil refineries. In the Iraq War, of course, the Iraqis set Kuwaiti oil fields on fire. And then the US has also attacked Iraqi oil fields more recently. We'll talk a little bit more about that as we go on. Now, part two, what are the current emissions? Well, unsurprisingly, because the United States is engaged in a global war on terror, and also has legacy forces and current missions and future missions projected all over the world, it has a global infrastructure to, like the British before us, to make sure that we have access to the capacity to move and project power. So this is the infrastructure of the war on terror. And the Defense Logistics Agency is responsible for securing all the fuel that's necessary for that. Here's a sample of what they do. They're located in 20 states and 8 countries. They have many distribution centers, and they supply fuel to the different services. In the context of US government energy consumption, as you can see from this, the DOD is the US government's largest energy consumer. In fact, it's so dominant that, as you can see, the total fuel use, energy consumption by the US tracks the DOD. When the DOD goes up, total US use goes up and goes down, it's correlated. And this shows basically what the fuel is used for. Most of it, the dominant portion of it is jet fuel, then diesel, and then there's some electrical energy consumption. But it's mostly vehicles and equipment. And here's the DOD fuel consumption. This is my calculation. Again, jet fuel is dominant. So if you think back to that previous slide where US consumption correlates with DoD consumption. It's really correlating largely with jet fuel consumption. So here we see the Defense Logistics Agency's purchases of millions of barrels of oil from 1998 to 2018. Again, jet fuel is dominant, but diesel is quite important. So jet fuel, obviously for aircraft, but diesel for ships and also for vehicles that are on the surface. Okay, and then here's the energy used by sector. Another way of thinking about it, vehicles and equipment. Then we have buildings in the blue and the orange. And what that tells you is that operations and transportation is most important, and the facilities are clearly important as well, but not as important. Okay, and here's the energy consumption by service for installation. So 70% of consumption is for operations and 30% for installations. And here's the breakdown, roughly equal among the services for installations. So this is where all that jet fuel goes. It goes to power very thirsty aircraft that are getting, let's say, a range of 4.9 gallons per mile to 4.2 gallons per mile, according to my calculations. They're not efficient vehicles. Okay, and then here's the calculation that I've done showing US Department of Defense greenhouse gas emissions. And I can show you at the end of this whole talk, if you're interested, how I derive these numbers. No one had ever done it. And I was really curious about the greenhouse gas footprint of the US military. So I got the raw data for the period of 1975 to 2008. And then I had some other data that was provided by the Department of Energy that was more aggregated. I didn't have to do the calculations up to 2019. And here's the result. And what you'll notice is obviously that this tracks with what? It tracks with US deployments. Okay, so this is a proxy. You know the United States is at war, or at either a hot war or a cold war, when emissions are up. Fuel use is up, emissions are up. And when it declines, we're in a period of either large-scale base closures or fewer exercises or both, or we're not in a hot war. Oops, Let's go back, if I can figure this out. Maybe I can't. Okay, there we go. All right, and here we see the Department of Energy's way of breaking this down. They break it down in terms of standard emissions and non-standard emissions. And basically standard emissions are those things like driving around, operating office buildings, basically non-military activities that are related to the kinetic use of force. So any uses of forces are in the non-standard emissions. The standard emissions are the sort of day-to-day activities. And then you see the total. Again, for the period of 2000 to 2019. And why I'm focusing here is on this period is it's before the global war on terror began and through the wars. And what you see is an uptick, of course, in the peak of activities in 2003, 2004, and then the emissions go down over time. And they're not really significantly peaking in 2011, which is the largest deployment in Afghanistan of over 100,000 troops. They remain basically steady. And one of the questions I have is why, and I looked into that. And they're also not significantly peaking at the Iraq surge. And I wanted to understand why, and I can tell you a little bit more about that later. But I'm also wanting to link this to strike sorties because aircraft, again, are the big users of fuel. And here we see, and we're going to go back to that previous slide in a moment. Here we see an uptick in strike sorties in 2017 through 2019 in Afghanistan. And if we go back, what we see is a slight uptick, which is actually a significant amount of greenhouse gases in the last year. And that's why it was important for me to get the most recent data, which came out this summer. We were on a steady decline, and now we're on an uptick. And that's related fairly clearly in my mind to the uptick in air strike sorties in Afghanistan in the run-up to the negotiations, the actual negotiations, and then a decline. But of course, we don't know the post-February 2020 data because the United States has stopped telling us about the number of airstrikes. Okay, so the bottom line is the US military is an enormous greenhouse gas emitter. Its emissions are greater than many countries' entire emissions. And here's a handy dandy Forbes chart based on my work, where you see we're very close to Morocco, Sweden, Peru. Portugal's another one that we're close to. Okay, so if you look at the world and find Portugal or Sweden, you can see that's roughly the size, but that also of US emissions, but that also tells you that it's a very small portion relatively to the entire US economy. Okay, so I've estimated the US emissions in war. They're roughly, this is my actual calculation, but they're roughly this amount. Of course, this is an estimation, right? So total greenhouse gas emissions for the period that I'm 2001 to 2019, about 1,323 million metric tons. And as you can see, war is only a portion of that. It's about a quarter of it. And again, we see that much of this is jet fuel emissions. But we also see at the same time from 1975 to 2018, decreasing emissions by DoD facilities use. So when we looked at that chart earlier and we saw that greenhouse gas emissions were declining in the post 2003-2004 peak, that is post-Cold War peak, it's because we've closed many facilities and facility energy use is therefore down. And we've also changed the type of fuel that's used in the facilities so that it's less coal, more natural gas. Okay, when you have less coal, you're putting out, because coal is a great greenhouse gas emitter, you have less greenhouse gas emissions. So if you look at the smaller table on the right, they're proportionate to the size of fuel consumption by the installations. And you also see the relatively decreased size of coal and also fuel oil, other high emitters. Okay, and here we see a closer breakdown of facilities energy use. And I'm putting these up so you can ask me questions about them later if you're interested. What I haven't estimated are emissions caused by the US military industry, those caused by direct targeting of petroleum, that is deliberately burning oil wells and refineries, the emissions of co-belligerents of the United States or US antagonists, the significant amount of emissions caused by reconstruction, in particular, the pouring of concrete, and emissions from other sources. And those are those fluorocarbons I mentioned earlier. Okay, so how does the Pentagon think about fuel use and climate change? And this is the thing you probably came to hear. The DoD through 2009 knew about climate change, but they really emphasized a traditional conception of security that is immediate national security threats. And climate change is long range, not so interesting. And they didn't feel moved to really take it into account. Post 2009, there are basically three foci: operational challenges of climate change, overwhelm that's potential as the US military has to respond to natural disasters, and the potential for increased conflict. There was early on in the 1990s, and here's a paper from 1990 at the Naval War College, a clear understanding of the fact that the Navy in particular would face challenges with fresh water supply and sea level rise. And they've seen it already. But in the 1997 negotiations for the Kyoto Protocol, the military was successful in keeping the calculations, the statement of emissions from the military out of each country's totals. And here we see a quote from Stuart Eisenstadt, who's acknowledging that they basically did this for security reasons. They didn't want to include US military emissions in the totals. There are some emissions that can be included, but basically anything to do with war would not be included. So, and here we see a missing image, which is me describing, apparently this didn't upload, me describing aerial attacks on ISIS oil infrastructure and assets. And what you see, what you would see, let me see if we've got something here, we don't, is the United States, when it in 2014 began to attack ISIS infrastructure, did so only on a small scale, and it's only about 1% of the strikes in 2014 and 2015. And then it jumps up in 2016 to about 12% of the strikes have impacts and destroy or damage ISIS oil infrastructure. In other words, it becomes increasingly important to attack oil infrastructure. So that's a traditional understanding of the role of oil and fuel in war. The other way the US military thinks about it is in terms of operational vulnerability of itself. And here we see the literal tether of fuel. And of course, as Mattis says, we want to cut the military, we want to cut the tether. There's also vulnerability through attacks on supply lines. And we saw at the peak of the United States military activities and force size in Afghanistan, many attacks, hundreds of attacks on NATO supply convoys. Often that entailed blowing up fuel as it was being transited from Pakistan into Afghanistan. So they want to reduce that operational vulnerability. And in the period between 2008 to the basically the present, the United States, in particular the Marines, have focused on greening themselves. They want to be lean, green fighting machines. So they've invested in solar and efficiency. And it's actually yielded very small results in terms of overall reductions, but all of those reductions, I would say most of those reductions are concentrated in operational areas. So better batteries, more solar, using lighter materials to increase efficiency and so on. Then there's the part of the DoD that focuses on climate change. And basically for them, the sky is falling. It really is. The issue is that facilities are more vulnerable. And here we see Ofut Air Force Base, which is flooded. They're concerned about a lot of bases. And here's all the assets that they've identified as vulnerable to the effects of climate change, either increased heat, drought, or flooding. Here's some images from Newport Naval Station. They're concerned about having to actually retreat from some of these locations, and adaptation may not be enough. Okay. But the other thing that they're interested in is understanding climate change caused instability. And that is, first of all, probably for them, migration. Secondly, responding to crisis. Thirdly, possible war, up to and including nuclear war. And in fact, when Admiral Samuel Locklear raised the importance of climate change, he was, as a potential conflict instability multiplier, he was criticized in the Congress by the folks who wanted to deny climate change. Okay, so the Obama administration was all over this. They said it was urgent and growing. Mattis was very concerned about climate change affecting operations. the Trump administration pulled climate change out of the national security strategy as a threat, and then Congress wrote to Trump and said, no, you have to put it back in. We need to take it seriously. So this is part of a pattern of securitizing climate change, saying that it will lead to necessarily increased risk and likelihood of conflict escalating into war. And here are some of the interesting books that have been published recently. So the theory basically is that climate puts stress on people, causing migration, for example, or a conflict over resources such as water that will, and maybe food, and that will lead to greater conflict. So how is the military not thinking about climate change? Well, first of all, they're not thinking about their contribution, which is, as I've said, hasn't been calculated very well until quite recently, one by me and one calculation by me and one by this trio, Oliver Belcher, Patrick Bigger, Ben Niemark, and Kara Kennedy, actually quartet. Okay, so the idea here is that war causes climate change and climate change causes war. Now we've got two parts of the cycle. It's recursive, and that's a problem. Okay, they're also not rethinking their global footprint. And the little chart on the bottom there shows how actually the United States is much less dependent in the last 20 years on oil from the Persian Gulf. Yet many assets from boots on the ground to folks in aircraft carriers and the associated surface ships are located in or on their way to and coming back from the Persian Gulf. And this has been a traditional mission of the United States military from the days of the Rapid Deployment Force through present incarnation in Central Command, that the United States should protect access to oil, easy flow, cheap oil. It's not as important for the US. It is important for US allies. They're also not thinking so much about the entire global footprint and the ways that US needs, like the coaling stations or sort of to have access to fuel, are increasing the fuel needs of the military, not so much on their radar. So they are, as I said, attacking oil fields, and they are, I think, recognizing the problems there with long fires, but that's in terms of decreasing potential, or actually decreasing the access and the price, increasing the price of oil. So here I show that table on ISIS infrastructure and the percent of strike sorties that resulted in destroyed or damaged oil infrastructure going up. That's what they've been doing. So then I have some slides on how to calculate US greenhouse gas emissions if you're interested in it. But the bottom line here is that, just to sum it all up, the United States has been, like most militaries in the world, incredibly dependent on fuel to get around. That fuel use has changed not only with the types of fuel being used and dependencies on fuel, the needs for the United States to have bases all over the world, or now decreased probably needs to have those bases, but it's also changed the global climate. And if the United States wants to put two and two together, thinking about how its fuel use and greenhouse gas emissions are increasing the threats that they most fear, then I think we could see some significant change in both the patterns of US fuel consumption for the military and the amount. And that could have salutary effects on the world. So I will stop there. And I know that was very quick. I had to go very quick because I had so many slides I wanted to show you. So I'll take your questions now.
Great, thanks so much. I'll manage the traffic in terms of the Q&A. Please raise your blue hand in Zoom if you'd like to ask a question, or please put something in the chat on YouTube. First question over to Phil Hahn.
So Neta, Phil Hahn here. I'm down at the Naval War College, so thanks for referencing one of my students' works there. I want to strengthen your argument. I've used your work over a long period of time in my research. One of the things that you omit is I didn't hear you talk about U.S. military nuclear power use.
Right.
It's an issue with jets. You don't bring up the fact that there's already been a substitution that's with the use of ships that has reduced the potential ability to reduce further. So I'll leave it at that. Can you talk to me how that fits in? Because I think if you at least acknowledge that, that'll strengthen your argument that this is the area where there can be more improvement over.
Sure. Thanks, Phil. It's Neta, actually long E. And yes, the entire submarine force, the attack force certainly has been nuclear powered for a long time. And much of the Navy is nuclear powered. That's true. And I think that is, you also, I talk about this in the paper, that is also part of the decline that I was trying to explain with installations. Yes, part of it is due to less bunker fuel being used on surface ships. So many surface ships and certainly the submarines are nuclear powered. Yeah, I agree, absolutely.
Great. Next, Barry Posen.
I'll try and get this right here.
You got it.
Hi, Anita, how you doing?
Good, how are you?
Great, great talk. Thanks for coming. I've been wondering about another issue for a while. I wonder if you've delved into it at all. And that is, has anyone tried to think about how the U.S. presence in the Persian Gulf subsidizes the price of oil and therefore subsidizes the price of carbon? Right. So we don't, you know, we have a problem politically imposing carbon taxes in the United States, but we also have this, what seems to me to be a secret carbon subsidy. And yeah, I'm not smart enough, RE economics or anything else, markets, to sort of figure out what the total impact of that subsidy might be, but I suspect it's not trivial. And I wonder if in your research, you've encountered anybody who's tried to do that work or whether you've started dabbling in it yourself. Thanks.
Okay. Yes, there is some work on the subsidy part of it. There's also work trying to figure out exactly how much of the total bill in any one year for operations is associated with the Persian Gulf. I think it's about 25% goes to CENTCOM, and then you could do a calculation. The subsidy's gone down though when you think, well, maybe the cost of the subsidy's gone up. It depends on how you think about it. The subsidy comes in the form of providing free and easy access to the oil, but it's actually vitiated by the fact that the U.S. military is such a large consumer itself, it's increasing demand, right? So it's keeping the price of oil up by having a higher demand. So it's on the one hand, keeping the price of oil down by increasing access supposedly, but it's also inflating it. And I haven't worked out the calculation on that. If you look at my greenhouse gas paper on the cost of war website, I think I've got the citations in there. The people have been trying to do the calculations on this. I don't think that anybody's done all of the math, the pluses and the minuses yet.
Great, thanks. Next, Emma Campbell-Mon. Emma, over to you.
Thank you so much. It's been a fascinating discussion. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about a small point you made. I'm wondering how the U.S. as an energy exporter is affecting Middle East posture, et cetera, and how that sort of affects your view for climate change and how it affects our allies. Thank you.
Well, it seems to me that the U.S. really hasn't changed its posture. The same bases are there basically since 1991. Obviously, except for the fact that there's more permanent presence in Iraq, though that's down. It's essentially the same situation since the early 1990s. Not much has changed. You know, one or two aircraft carriers are almost always there. The whole, you know, even with declining dependence on the Persian Gulf, there's not been a rethink of the necessity for that presence. It's obviously there for other reasons in addition to protecting oil. I mean, those reasons may actually not be good enough, or they could be accomplished by other, those ends could be accomplished by other means, but there hasn't been a rethink of that. And that's part of my point. There's essentially, and we would expect this given the ways that organizations and bureaucracies work, there's little rethinking of the basic mission. There has to be a shock of some kind, and there hasn't been that kind of shock.
Great, thanks. Let's see. Next, Trevor Prouty. Trevor, over to you.
Thanks, Taylor. I think, you know, my question goes into some of the advances or work that has been done in the services on this type of thing. And I guess in truth and advertising, Navy commander speaking, right? So I guess I have some purchase in this game, particularly the gray green fleet that was sailed in 2016, a strike group powered completely by one half, biofuel and then one half petroleum. That was a success. But I think specifically my question is that just like the rest of most of the military and government, we're driven largely by the commander in chief's desires and a budget that's appropriated and signed by Congress. So I think specifically my question is, from a military perspective, how much of this can we control? I'd argue that a lot of the technology innovation is there, but without the guidance from above, we're kind of at the whim of our chain of command. And I just wonder your thoughts on that and what your thoughts on the Great Green Fleet were.
Mm-hmm. I think the Great Green Fleet was a wonderful exercise in marketing, and it was wonderful in two senses. It showed that there's potential for biofuel and that the Navy can be innovative, but in another sense, it sort of distracted from the things that the military is not doing. So yes, wonderful. And I think it sort of gave us the sense of potential for the military to be innovative. Okay, and then on your second question about whether or not you need the commander in chief to be innovative and be even more green, I think that's so. I think Congress also has a role. But I also wanted to acknowledge that the 2009 order by Obama was essentially rescinded by Trump. That is, the order to be greener in facilities and greener in operations, to be much more efficient, essentially rescinded by the Trump administration. And the military's just kept on with its operational efficiencies. So they've not directly defied this. They've not said, we're not gonna do it, but they're just doing what they were doing already. And I think the argument is, if they were asked, they were pressed by anyone who's paying attention in the NSC, would be that these are operational efficiencies and we need them to cut the tether to fuel. It's about mission effectiveness and decreasing vulnerabilities of our forces who are transiting the fuel and so on. So I don't see a lot of leadership coming from the White House now, and they've just kept going.
Great, thanks. Next, Eric Sand, over to you, Eric.
Thanks, Taylor. Thanks, Nina. This was a really interesting presentation. I really appreciate it. I was hoping you could provide two numbers for context. You did a little bit with the graphics, but what percentage of US greenhouse gas emissions come from the Department of Defense, and what percentage of global greenhouse gas emissions come from the Department of Defense?
Don't have those numbers that tip of my tongue. Small. Okay. Both numbers are small. Just, you know, like 5%, something like that for the DOD. Now, the DOD's direct emissions, but you get a much larger number, and I'm not happy with my calculation yet on this, when you include military industries. Remember, there are things I said that I didn't include in the calculations. So I included direct emissions from the DOD from its facilities, infrastructure, and operations. Okay, that's what I've calculated scope, but they're called scope one and scope two. I did not include scope three emissions in my calculations, which are things like military industry or people driving to and from work. I didn't include that. Okay, if we included military industry, and I think that there's about 800,000 people, and again, I don't have my paper in front of me, but this is about what I remember, about 800,000 people working in military industry in any one year. That's about 15% or so in any one year of US industrial workers. And if that's right, then, and let's say roughly 15% of all industrial emissions are related to the military industrial complex and is making stuff that goes to the military, then it's really much larger, okay, huge, because the United States industrial economy is huge. Okay, but I'm not happy with my calculations on that yet because there's so much I don't know.
Thanks.
Great, thanks. Next, Tyler Bowen. Tyler, over to you.
Yeah, I was, thank you for the talk. I was quite fascinated. I have a question related to Trevor's question about, it seems like he said, it seems like the commander in chief for Congress has a lot of control over the budget and you need action by them. You probably also need action, by the U.S., by the overall U.S. public, because, I would have to think that the U.S. military does, in some senses, see this as a collective action problem. So my question is you mentioned the attempts at securitizing climate change. Do you think that that's part of a way to get people to act more on it, like to get political leaders to take the problem more seriously? And if so, do you think that's a good strategy for sort of energizing political mm-hmm. leaders and members of the US public to care more and do more about climate change?
I think that is true, that it's part of a strategy for drawing attention to the issues. But secondly, I think it is also the case that we've already seen instances where climate change has either deepened an ongoing conflict or might in fact been the spark of conflicts. Okay, so I don't think that it's made up, this link between security and climate change. I think it's real. But the research shows that the capacity of governments to mitigate and adapt will decrease the security implications of climate change. So if governments work and have the capacity to respond to climate emergencies or sort of longer term trends, then the security implications go down. Right, so that the risk of climate caused conflict and migration decrease. So yeah, it might be a good thing if what you're doing is marketing. It might be a bad thing if what the consequence is that you increase military spending. Because what I didn't say and what I could have described is the tight correlation between military spending and greenhouse gas emissions. Unless and until the US military becomes quite green, or becomes a carbon sink by converting its bases to growing trees and so on, the military spending will be highly correlated with emissions. Okay, if we increase military spending because we're afraid of climate war coming to a neighborhood near you, then that's any advantages are vitiated by this increased carbon emissions.
Great, thanks. So we have a question from someone watching on YouTube who you may know, Professor Flank here. Great to see you. I was wondering, are you distinguishing between quote site and quote source emissions? Could this make a difference comparing jet fuel versus base electricity?
Hi, Steve. And the answer is that I'm using the DOE, Department of Energy, scope one and scope two emissions, which look at basically facilities as part of standard emissions, and then the operational emissions or non-standard emissions. Okay, so they're not directly equivalent, and that might be the source of some confusion. I'm using the DOE numbers because the DOD doesn't provide the data. Sorry. To use DOD data, and to do what you're asking, I'd have to have a Department of Defense that was willing to share information. We don't, sadly.
Hence, more research is required. So thanks for that, Professor Blank. Next, Eric Lynn Greenberg. Eric, over to you.
Yeah, thanks so much for the talk. It was super interesting. I was wondering if you might talk a little bit more about, you know, whether or not the changing character of warfare towards more cyber operations, smaller footprint, soft operations, things of that nature, will have any effect on kind of the future trajectory of DoD emissions. Obviously, they make up a relatively small portion of DoD operations, but I think that might change in the future. And I think we've seen a good deal of investment and spending going into those sectors. So thanks.
I don't think that it will have a significant impact, because as I've shown, it's jet fuel. Now, if the United States wants to not have aircraft carriers, you know, hither and yon, and if the United States decides that it doesn't need long-range strike aircraft, then you'll see significant reductions in emissions. Now, there is work on, you know, changing the ways that aircraft fly, their materials, and so on to decrease their emissions. And that would have, that could have an important impact, but I don't see cyber and any switch to cyber warfare as having a significant impact on emissions. Unless it's so huge that you need a lot of cooling to be done of server farms. Okay, so it could increase emissions if that's what you get.
Great, thanks. Next question, Suzanne Freeman. Suzanne, over to you.
Hi, thank you so much for this really interesting and important talk. My question was about sort of on those carrier operations and flying planes. My understanding is that sort of the MQ-25, the air-to-air refueling drone, is supposed to sort of help with the fuel dumping issue, but also that there's sort of some issues with like pilots being willing to culturally accept the use of this technology. And so I was curious sort of if there are other types of technologies that the US military is trying to use to decrease some of these emissions, but that might be having difficulty being accepted, or if really it's just that there's not a whole lot of action being taken.
Well, I think this is all, you're asking a really important military culture question. And I think that it's always the case that it's hard to get people to change the ways that they've been trained to do things, including how to fly. And so most of the fuel is used as with a commercial aircraft in takeoff and landing. Right. So they're working on having manned aircraft fly different flight profiles. If you go higher up in the atmosphere, haven't talked about water vapor as an issue, but water vapor is also an issue. If you fly lower, you get less water vapor and then less warming. So there are changes that have been talked about. The RAND Corporation has been doing research on this and feeding that into the Air Force. But all of this has to be trained and adopted. And this, of course, takes time. So, and then in terms of fuel dumping isn't really the major issue. It's actual fuel burning. That's the major problem here. Of course, there is fuel dumping by commercial aircraft. All aircraft could dump fuel if they need to avoid a crash, but that isn't really the major issue. I'm looking at real combustion.
Great, thanks. Next, Nina Miller. Nina, over to you.
Thank you for this really interesting talk, Nita. I was curious about sort of two points you raised about securitization and the point about sort of military spending being correlated with climate emissions. And I was wondering if you saw evidence of this sort of securitizing language being used to justify larger budget requests, which would itself be kind of evidence that this securitization of climate change is leading to more climate change. Thank you.
I think that's happening with the Navy and has been. Absolutely. The Navy's been at the forefront in doing the scientific analysis and saying how their missions need to be changed. I mean, most obviously the question of operations in the Arctic. Should the Arctic always be open and who will be in there? And if the Russians are there, then we need a greater presence. And so you see it feeding into arguments about increasing the size and changing the operations of the force. And that's really one of the few areas, in fact, I said most of the time the military isn't really rethinking its mission significantly. Thinking about the Arctic is where they are, and the Navy's at the forefront there. And yes, it has budgetary implications.
Great, thanks. Eleanor Freund, Eleanor, over to you.
Thanks, Neta, for a really interesting talk. I have two questions for you. The first has to do with other militaries and how they're approaching this issue. I'm curious if other countries have taken any efforts to reduce greenhouse gas emissions in their own militaries and how that has gone and what it might suggest about efforts to do so in the US. And then my second question has to do with the point you made about climate change leading to conflict. And I'm curious what you see as being the most likely pathways in those conflicts. Thanks.
Okay. I'm racking my brain to think about examples of other militaries that are concerned about these issues. I think that because the United States military is the largest actor by far, its activities are most significant. That said, people in Germany, Sweden, and the UK have been in contact with me and asked for the list of recommendations that I gave to the Congress, members of Congress, and they've fed those into their processes. I don't know what's come of it. So I don't know what was underway before. But the more innovative economies are doing more, period. So Germany is ahead and in terms of reductions in emissions. And I don't think it's a high priority for most militaries. The US could lead here too. It could make it a high priority. And then in terms of the conflict mechanisms that you asked about, I think there are really two. One is to the extent that there are water shortages, issues about access to fresh drinking water are gonna be very important. You know, people talk about how the United States, they're even talking about the United States and Canada relationship, because most of our fresh water is in the Great Lakes, when you think about it. But the Canadians and the Americans have access to that water. There's speculation among some people about this leading to conflict. Now, would it be a conflict that could be resolved with an economic agreement, payments? Would it escalate to war? I don't think it would necessarily escalate to war because of the norms and the longstanding relationship. I think that's on the extreme end of risk, sort of risk inflation, right? But closer, and more likely to cause conflict are things like the relationship between India and Pakistan over fresh water, China and its neighbors, and then of course displacement causing some conflict. Or being fueling conflict, right? Some people say that the long drought in the Middle East is part of the spark for the war in Syria. I think that there's evidence that there's lots of causes for the Syrian civil war, but it may be a contributing factor. So I think there are examples, yes, of that are credible about climate change causing changes in people's behavior or ability of resources that could lead to armed conflict.
Great, thanks. So this will be the last question for the live stream portion. It comes from David Logan in the chat, but he was in a noisy environment, so he did not want to go into Zoom. He has two questions. I'll just pick one, which is, second, there are certainly things that the US military does that other non-military actors don't, flying jets, so it may be hard to directly compare emissions-related efficiency, but to the extent that you can compare on similar activities, like say running office buildings, is the US military particularly better or worse from an emission standpoint than other actors?
I don't know. I suspect that the US is getting better in terms of office buildings. And that's what those, I had a chart there showing office buildings that that had tried to reduce emissions, and then the office buildings that were not part of a program to reduce emissions. And there are some DOD office buildings which are part of that. The Pentagon, being the world's largest office building, is obviously a huge contributor to the office building portion of US emissions. But I don't have a good sense of that. That's a good question. And it's something maybe I'll have to include in the book for those who are interested.
Great. Well, thanks to everyone who joined us on YouTube. This will conclude sort of the live stream portion of the seminar. And now we'll move internally to some